For 5 decades, Rolling Stone magazine has been the home of the cool, the groundbreaking, and the controversial. And while its focus is music, its influence is stretched into pop culture, entertainment, and politics, ultimately becoming the cultural Bible for baby boomers. Jan Wenner has been at the helm of Rolling Stone since he founded it in 1967. 50 years ago this Thursday, the magazine's being celebrated with a new HBO documentary airing this week and a new coffee table book. Jan, always nice to see you. Good morning.
Good to
see
you.
How you doing?
How you doing? Well.
Give me the two-sentence mission statement when you founded the magazine.
Rolling Stone is for the people who believe in rock and roll and believe it's the magic that can set you free. It's not just about music, but all the attitudes and ideas that music embraces.
That was 1967. Tell me the moment, the cover, the story, whatever, when you realized you had entered the consciousness of this country, when you said, we've made it, we've achieved our mission statement.
Well, I don't, it's not made it all the time, but I remember the first sort of big flurry we were involved in, we printed that cover of John Lennon, Yoko Ono naked on our first anniversary issue in 1968. And, you know, we got some coverage there, and we got a headline in the local newspaper that says, Naked Beatle Perils SF.
Yeah, so, and that photo, by the way, one of the most famous photos we'll ever see. It's also very poignant. You put it on the cover of the magazine shortly after he died. I
think that's a different picture.
Okay, but I think Annie Leibovitz shot that other photo of him, I think on the day or the day before
the day
he was
before.
Actually
yeah.
killed.
Yeah.
When you look back at the times that you've had in the magazine, what are you most proud of in terms of a social issue that you got ahead of?
Well, we've been really strong on gun control. We followed that for a long time. It's an outrage that nothing's been done. We've been very strong on pot legalization, which is getting done. And now we're involved in one of the leading publications to be discussing climate change.
1985, you did a two-part article on the AIDS epidemic.
That's correct.
At a time when this country was still trying to get its head around what this was, do you think you changed the conversation?
It was the first big, real big national piece about AIDS, and it brought it to everybody's attention. I think, you know, it was popping up here and there, and there was some discussion, but the whole issue hadn't been focused and crystallized into one really coherent explanation of what was going on, and that was going to be an epidemic.
The person who's been on the cover more than anyone else is Bob Dylan.
Bob Dylan.
But was that purely because of your own personal fandom?
No, it's just that Bob, during his entire 50 years, keeps working, keeps putting out albums, and despite his reputation as a recluse, is always out there on the never-ending tour. Is it Bob Lennon?
Yeah, Bob Dylan. Yeah, that's according to our research.
I'm sure you're right.
1992, you and some others interviewed then-candidate Bill Clinton.
Right.
What did you recognize in him that told you he was going to be a political force?
Well, you know, he was young, very eloquent and spoken, and he just had a really glib thing about him. I mean, he was personable.
And he knew how to handle the media. He knew how to use the media.
He was young and charming.
In 2013, August, you put a cover picture of Zohar Tsarnaev, one of the Boston bombers, on the cover of the magazine.
Right.
Boy, did you take some heat for that.
Right.
A lot of people said you glamorized him. You treated him like a celebrity and a rock star.
Mm-hmm.
Was it a mistake?
Well, I think, looking back, I think I would not have done it again if I had a choice. I think the cover is so powerful an idea and so iconic a place to be that in people's minds is reserved for heroes only. And here was a villain, and it was a mistake to have a villain celebrate. Plus, that picture, he looked like a rock star. He looked like the kid who lived next door, kind of. And also, that aspect of it really irritated people.
So would that
it was
be
a
your
great
one?
Story, but I would not have put
was
it on
Was that your
cover.
Biggest do-over, or are there some others?
Well, the one other one is the University of Virginia case, in which we got, you know, really duped by somebody who came in and sold us a story that was false.
You have yourself achieved the level of fame now that you've been covering for many years. What's the one thing you learned about fame that you didn't know before you achieved it?
I don't know. I don't think anything. You know, I know if you're you get good reservations, good restaurants quickly. You know, that's about the best of it.
There's something in the headlines right now I just want to get you before you go away. You're not happy with a biography of you that's just come out?
Yeah, it's kind of turned out to be rather shallow.
You called it deeply flawed and tawdry, and then you used a bull blank word.
Yeah.
You commissioned the book.
I agree.
Isn't the book in some ways kind of like one of an article that would appear in Rolling Stone magazine?
Not at all. No? It's shallow and very inaccurate and really against all the kind of standards of excellence in journalism and writing that we have.
Are you going to be commissioning any other books?
One on you.
Yeah, great. Good luck with that. Jan Wenner, thanks very much.
Pleasure. Good
it's
to
always
see
good
you.
To have you here. Congratulations on 50 years of Rolling Stone. We're back in a moment.
Hello, Today fans. Thanks for checking out our YouTube channel. Subscribe by clicking that button down there and click on any of the videos over here to watch the latest interviews, show highlights, and digital exclusives.